card, then a talk with some, or sorry, a discussion with some short presentations on soft hair, and then we'll discuss more broadly black hole information this afternoon. So let's go ahead and get started with Gerard talking on the quantum black hole from standard physics.
Can you hear me now? Okay, good. So thank you very much. I've been here also about a month ago giving a very similar talk on the same subject as today. But my experience is that I can give this talk as many times as I want, explaining people how to get around the no-go theorems. Then after I gave the talk, I just continue to do the thing which in my eyes is can be avoided. But anyway, let me just try to formulate my things again. And in the beginning, you might think that this is hard, difficult to believe, because it seems to be counterintuitive. And it's true that there are three or four simultaneous features that you have to understand. And if you don't, nothing seems to work. So it's very important to get these mechanisms work together. Now, where's the... Yes, here it is. So let me first start the same way as Steve started in the beginning of his talk, which is ask what we demand our theory to do. And when we quantize a system, what we want is a Hilbert space spanned by an orthonormal set of elementary states called basis elements. This sounds so trivial that many people don't give it much thought. But here it is very important. Orthonormality, Hilbert space. And later you can make as many superpositions as you want. You can entangle until, the whole world is entangled. That makes no difference. You basically need an orthonormal set of states. And then you have to say of each of these states what they mean, what they stand for physically. So you have to, at every orthonormal element of the basis of a Hilbert space, you have a story saying this describes a particle so and so, and then you need an evolution operator. That evolution operator must be unitary. And again, this sounds very simple and straightforward. In ordinary quantum physics, it always works out this way, that the evolution operator is unitary. That is, e to the minus I ht is unitary, provided H is Hermitian, and it always works, so you don't give it very much thought. In this case, it's very important to focus on this unitarity of the evolution operator that you grab out of the air somehow. Well, I will grab it out of the air, but I'll say at the same time that this is what is suggested by all the local interactions that I know about. So that's the word standard physics. I'm using standard physics to derive the evolution operator that I want to have. And indeed, I'll then show that in agreement with standard physics, it is a unitary operator. But it's all very non-trivial, and well, you'll see as I go along. So in particular, you demand a notion called completeness. That is, the unitary operator maps a state onto another state, but that other state should be an element of your Hilbert space. And as soon as you map something onto a state that you hadn't foreseen in your original setup, then unitarity goes astray. And that happens with very many proposals about black holes. You don't understand how the evolution operator can be unitary at all. So that's completeness. I claim it can be done for a black hole. The Hilbert space is derived from very simply in the very end from a system of quantized fields on a certain background, a non-trivial space-time background on which I put quantized fields. I put ordinary quantized fields in a domain of physics where I believe that the quantum field theory works. That is, none of the particles should get energies anywhere close to the Planck scale, because then I run into great difficulties. But as long as the energies are below the Planck scale, then you think you can believe, to some extent, quantum field theory. In most cases, you can do perturbation expansion in quantum field theory. Okay, fine. I do it in a background metric, but the metric itself might also fluctuate. And that's, of course, described having gravitons in there. So I'll put a standard quantum field theory, add to that perturbative gravity, and then put that in that space-time, which itself is non-perturbative. So that space-time is, of course, like the Schwarzschild metric, and that system does is obtained by solving non-perturbatively the Einstein equations. But for the rest, everything is perturbative, but the great challenge is to avoid these non-unitary features that you are running out of your Hilbert space. You have runaway solutions. A typical example that is, of course, the self-radiation of an electron. You get into states that you hadn't foreseen, that where the electron gets very, very fast accelerations. And that, then, if you're not careful, your theory will cease to be unitary. It all begins with the gravitational back reaction. And it is known by now, many people are looking at it, and they say, well, it gives a slight complication. In my case, this is not a complication, it's the starting point. Without gravitational back reaction, nothing works, of what I'm going to say later. So this is very, very important. The gravitational back reaction, well, yesterday we saw some arguments about the gravitational field of a particle moving in or out a black hole, and very soon people were discussing particles with a rest mass bigger than the Planck mass. But that's not the domain where I can do quantum field theory, so I have to assume that all particles living in this metric of the background field must have energies below the Planck mass. But even though the energy is below below the Planck mass, it might, under some circumstances, not stay there. It might run into a domain where the energy of a particle, the kinetic energy that is, runs beyond the Planck mass. So I have to be very careful, and to get things straightened up, I must first study what happens when a particle moves too fast. So this fast-moving particle will later be eliminated, but before doing so, I have to understand what it does. So I have to understand what is the gravitational field of a very fast-moving particle. This is a well-known problem, and it's totally standard physics to solve it. All you need to do is take a particle at rest. Then its gravitational field is, as indicated here, just basically spherically symmetric. Maybe the thing rotates, that it's slightly away from spherical symmetry, but basically this is the Schwarzschild metric of a particle at rest. Now all you have to do is Lorentz boost it. And now I'm going to Lorentz boost it such that its energies will get beyond the Planck scale. So that's a dangerous domain, I know, but in this case, the Lorentz transformation is straightforward to carry out. You just take a very, very large gamma factor, and what you get is known by everybody, particularly in this laboratory where in the Alice lab you detect and you study what happens when nuclei of atoms are going this ultra-relativistic speed, they undergo a Lorentz contraction. So this particle also undergoes a Lorentz contraction. Here you see the particle Lorentz contracted. But not only the particle is, the gravitational field is as well. That's not totally trivial, it's something you have to calculate. So you have to take this field, perform a large Lorentz transformation, and you find that the field actually takes this shape. This is very familiar in physics. It happens also with electromagnetism. If you have an electrically charged particle, you can give the same story, saying what's the particle at rest, its Coulomb field is nicely spherically symmetric, but when the particle moves very fast, the Coulomb field takes this shape. It's only non-vanishing in this very flat, narrow region. Before that, there's no Coulomb field. Behind that, there's no Coulomb field. There might be a non-trivial vector potential. In a gauge theory, yeah, you work with vector potentials. They might not vanish, but you can transform them back to the case where there's no vector potential. Similarly here, the metric tensor might be non-trivial, but you can find a gauge such that you have completely flat space here. You've also completely flat space here. But the two flat spaces are joined in a funny way. They are joined with curvature. So there is a non-trivial physical curvature here on the seam between these two flat spaces. And this curvature reflects basically the gravitational field that you have here. And this is a straightforward calculation that you can do. I won't repeat it. I just give the answer. And the answer is by now well known that and it was derived long before us by these people, and it might even go further, even more, because this is a very elementary exercise that many people must have done. You take this fast particle, and what you find is there's flat space in front of the particle, there's flat space behind the particle. This is a situation where time runs vertically, space runs horizontally, and this is going basically with the speed of light. Very, very tiny little bit slower than the speed of light, but basically that's negligible for all practical purposes. The thing moves at the speed of light. I take the limit where the rest mass goes to zero and the Lorentz boost goes to infinity, such that the momentum of the particle is a fixed value. And then you find that these two flat spaces are joined together with a shift, and that shift is exactly proportional to the momentum of this particle. It is proportional, so it's a linear function of the momentum. That linearity is going to be very important for me. It means that things will be soluble. And but this coordinate, this is a light cone coordinate, u minus, so u are my coordinates in this frame. And so delta u minus is the shift. Now, if the shift were the same everywhere for particles that have a small impact parameter and particles that have a big impact parameter, if the shift were the same everywhere, you would just say, okay, that's easy. I take this flat space, I give it new coordinates that are shifted by the amount delta u, and then this whole effect disappears. But just like in the electromagnetic case, you can't do that because the gauge transformation in the electromagnetic case depends on the transverse variable. So here you see this fast-moving particle, a slow-moving particle going by it, but this distance varies, and the shift turns out to be proportional to the logarithm of that separation. If this were a linear function, you could also transform it away by a Lorentz transformation, but since this is a log, you can't transform it away at all, not everywhere at the same time. Of course, the log comes with a constant. That constant can be removed by a coordinate transformation, but not the log itself. Its first derivative can also be removed, but the physical effect is the tidal force from this particle, and that goes as a second derivative of this logarithm. So the strength of the tidal forces that you actually feel go like 1 over x minus x prime squared. So that's the answer to this exercise, and this shift is going to be very important for me because it's going to do everything that I want to do. In particular, you have to note that the shift can go to infinity very easily because an ingoing particle has a momentum that, as seen by an observer who proceeds in time, he thinks that the momentum of the ingoing particle increases exponentially with time. So that exponential increase of this delta P means that delta U also increases exponentially. And now you see why you must be doing it completely wrong if you neglect this force, because how can you neglect something that increases exponentially in time? Even if it starts to be very, very small, very quickly this shift becomes very, very big. And it's always proportional to delta to P. And I'm going to use this to perform something which is already quite non-trivial and which most people haven't even tried to see, but it's going to solve the problem. The problem is that this shift is a relative shift. It's a shift compared to the case when this ingoing particle wasn't there. But now the thing is, I can use all ingoing particles to define a shift operator here. So once the black hole has been formed, I can consider any other set of ingoing particles, and then once black hole has been formed, the outgoing particle would have gone out here. But now if I send in anything more into the black hole, it causes this shift. Now, that is a relative shift, a shift compared to what you had if you didn't have this extra particle going in. But now let's consider all ingoing particles. And now you say, if you consider all ingoing particles, this is not a relative shift, it's an absolute shift. It's just a coordinate, the coordinate of the outgoing particle. Well, that will need to be renormalized, because if you look at the particle which is very at the black hole which is very old, then the ingoing matter has a gigantically blown up exponential momentum. So if you use that to define the coordinate of this particle, the zero of the coordinate frame is very, very far away. So you're going to rearrange that zero, and there you have lots of freedom in doing that. And that actually means that the description of the black hole at first sight doesn't seem to be unique at all. It depends on where you put the zero of this coordinate. But let's assume you have put the zero somewhere, then this delta u can be replaced by u itself. So that's why the delta is given in a different color. It means you can remove the delta, and that also means you can remove the delta here. You can say this p minus is the absolute momentum of everything that went into the black hole, except for the very formation process, which is long ago, and which after some time I can't find out anymore. The system does carry a memory, but I can't get out of the memory how it was formed long ago. What I see is basically a time stationary black hole. I can do this with the ingoing particle, and at first sight it looks as if the outgoing particle, whatever shifts and goes, doesn't affect the ingoing particle at all. That's not quite true. It does affect the ingoing particle, but then you have to make a Lorentz transformation where you go into the frame where this particle stands still and that particle moves with the same Lorentz boost in the other direction. Then this becomes a very heavy particle with a large value p plus out in now in the light cone plus direction, and then this particle is being shifted. Peculiarly, remarkably, this is the same effect as that. Why is that so? Well, if you shift the momentum of the particle, then the position gets shifted. But in quantum theory, the commutator between momentum and position is I. You have to be very careful here now, because this is a different particle from that one. So this momentum of this particle does not anti-commute, that commutes with the momentum of that one, or the position of that one. But you can go from position space to momentum space, and then this shift turns out to turns into this shift. So it's basically physically the same phenomenon. Also, that's very important. That's quantum mechanics already, but I'm going to do quantum mechanics more accurately than this. So the rule now is that it might not be correct to count the in particles independently from the out particles. There are particles going into a black hole, there are particles going out of a black hole, but what I'll say now is that all the information in this particle will be left behind in the other particle as well. That's not quite true. Again, I'm lying a bit, because this particle might have other quantum numbers than just momentum. All the other quantum numbers disappear. They become invisible. Only the momentum is being found back in the outgoing particle. So already here I have to make one assumption which is very important. That is, only the momentum will be enough to set up a unitary Hilbert space. So if I know all the momentum of the incoming particles, I know exactly my element of Hilbert space. That is not obvious. It's not true in ordinary quantum field theories. So right now, I have to say, well, I need a special quantum theory where this is true. This is why yesterday I interrupted Rafael Busso's talk, because he said that his theorem holds for all quantum field theories. But the quantum field theory where my procedure works is a very special one, where momentum of the particle should suffice to describe all the states in Hilbert space, the entire Fock space.
Yes. Why is that not usually the case? I mean, which variables are not?
Well, all quantum numbers which have nothing to do with momentum, like charges or Yukawa or fermionic numbers, baryon number, lepton number, all these things seem not to be transmitted in the outgoing particle.
Because they don't couple to the metric? I mean, they do, like charge, let's say, for example.
Okay. Well, you can now. Only here, I invite you briefly to look at string theory. In string theory, everything is also geometrical. So as long as momentum is strongly related to geometry of the particles, it's basically the canonical conjugate operator of position, and position, of course, is geometry. So in string theory, you have the same phenomenon, that the geometry of the string tells you everything about the particle. It also tells you what gauge theory you're looking at, and so on. So, and actually, you can say it more precisely. You can say that when you do a string theory calculation, you put vertex insertions in that string. Those vertex insertions are just e to the I px and nothing else. And if you take two different vertex insertions, you have two particles. If those vertex insertions coincide, you don't know whether it's two particles or one particle. And the strange thing is, in string theory, people get away with this. That is to say, it's sometimes the two vertex insertions can coincide, and you don't know the difference anymore between a two-particle state and a one-particle state. In practice, you say, I don't care, because I have to do these Chan-Payton integrations and so on, and then I have a big different physical situation when I talk about two particles than when I talk about one particle. But you have to remember that you have to make that integral before you could say such a thing, and that's non-trivial. So the same situation is happening here. So in this respect, the theory I'm going to talk about looks a bit like string theory. Yes, Steve?
Yeah, so I have a different question. So let's suppose we have basically a featureless quantum field theory, something like a scalar field.
Yes.
Just one scalar field interacting with gravity. My question is whether we really should think of the Hilbert space of that theory in conventional quantum field theory with gravitational interactions as behaving that way or whether that's an extra ingredient. Because we do have asymptotic states corresponding to, you know, say, left and right or in and outgoing particles. And there's some interaction between them, and you know that's going mm-hmm. to influence the asymptotic states in the future. But I'm not sure if we have this identification of the
five. No, I haven't given my story yet.
Okay.
So,
you're departing from the conventional picture?
Already here, the departure is, even for scalar field theories, this is not quite true. Because for scalar field theories, I could take 26 particles or one particle and put those 26 particles into such a state that it has the same momentum distribution as the one particle. Well, those states must be indistinguishable now because the outgoing particles are all the same because they're only determined by that shift. That is, so even in scalar field theory, it's not trivial. In fermionic theories, you are coming closer because you can only have your, in every momentum state, you can only have one or zero fermions. Then you're coming close to a situation where you can say, well, this is going to be one-to-one. But this is going to be a difficulty that I haven't completely solved. So if you attack me on that front, I say, yes, I have questions to ask myself here too. But basically, this is the idea that and I'll say it already now, and I'll repeat it many times later, that the ingoing particle carries information with it. It transports that information onto the outgoing particle. So I shouldn't count both the in and the outgoing particles in my Hilbert space. My Hilbert space is defined either by giving all the characteristics of the ingoing particle, then whatever the outgoing particle does follows. Or I give the characteristics of the outgoing particle, then the ingoing particle has already been taken into account. I shouldn't count both particles independently in my Hilbert space.
Could I have independent initial data, for example, that I
no.
predict?
Your initial data, you didn't yet say what the outgoing particles were. If you're in your initial data, you only see the in particles. That's what initial means.
Okay.
You haven't yet specified the out particles.
I
have a more careful way of saying of doing these things, and so. Yes, doing this work, many times I thought, now I've done something completely wrong and I have to start all over again. But then you do the calculation, you see everything works together the way exactly the way I say it. And that is by itself surprising. So one good way to count particles is to say, well, whatever frame I'm in, either the in particle has a beyond Planckian value of its momentum, or the out particle. But if the in particle has a very strong momentum, the out particle has been shifted so far that in position space, its wave function will be spread a lot, just because its shift will be spread by the wave function of the in particle in its momentum space. So either the in particle or the out particle will have energies below the Planck mass, or at least to a large extent, their state is defined by energies below the Planck mass. So you just have to look at which particle goes faster, the in particle or the out particle. The slowest particle I will count, then the fast particle will already be having taken into account, and I don't have to count that again. This way, I can ensure that all particles in my system will be particles that I call soft particles, whose masses are below the Planck mass. Yes?
I consider a situation where I first make the black hole quantum collapse, and then after a long time, I throw more matter in.
Yes, that's roughly the situation that you would consider. Yes. So this way, I claim I can keep all momenta small. Again, this is not totally obvious. Maybe there are some wave functions which both have components where P minus is big and where the outgoing momentum is big as well. So again, here you can ask all sorts of questions. And only the proof here is eating the pudding. And that's what I will do. I'll eat this, do the calculation, and then say, OK, all your worries were unsubstantiated because the calculation works. But there is certainly reason to worry at this stage. And then I'll say, what I've been doing here was so drastic, it has a consequence for space-time topology. And I'll have to explain that, of course, a lot more. Now, a remarkable thing, a question you can now ask is, what are nearest neighbors in this case? So if I have a very strong momentum here going to the left, then actually the point here is identified as a point there. So these A and A prime are neighbors. That's the reason why this particle is being shifted about. And in the other picture, where you have the outgoing particle, very strong momentum, but the ingoing particle is soft, then this point is a direct neighbor of that. What I want is that after some time, I can no longer detect what these particles were. Of course, I might still be able to detect this shift, but now I say, well, this situation is the same as this situation. So what you see now here is a transformation that looks very innocent, but it's very important. If I just change the picture like this way, then the out particle is where it was before anyway. So I've not changed any of the out particles. I've changed the ingoing particle, saying that its information is now carried by this particle. I don't need the in particle anymore. So now the out particle is going out like this. And now you see that the geodesic of the out particle is as if this in particle wasn't there at all. So if I say the information is in my out particle, I can say the in particle, I've taken you into account, everything is fine, and I'll drop you. And I can do that in this case, but if I go to the past, I can do it with the out particles. If the out particle has a very high momentum, the in particle is shifted, I can say, well, I've characterized the in particle by its new momentum after the out particle came out. I can't go back anymore to check this space-time. So now a black hole is in this description of this metric. And this is what I call a firewall transformation, because you can imagine that this way I've removed this firewall. And this is very essential. If you don't do that, these ingoing particles, not only outgoing particles, also the ingoing particles form a firewall. In this picture, it's the outgoing Hawking radiation that has been boosted to very high energies, and so the outgoing Hawking particles form a firewall. This is what caused the difficulties that people thought that the Hawking particles, if the very energetic Hawking particles that you see at the very early stage of the black hole, that they make the crossing of this line invalid. So I have to repair the theory by saying, okay, I don't know what happens in the past, but now I do as if what happened in the past was that this particle isn't there anymore. But I keep the out particles in the same position. So now the out particles here, the in particles here define the state, not the out particles. Here the out particles define the state, not the in particles. But removing the in particles means that I'm going to a different metric. Yes?
Just working backwards from the outcome of the whole story, so the out particles carry information in your picture.
Yes.
They do in any picture where we assume unitarity.
Right.
So whether or not they were shifted in some way, at the end of the day, they're coming out to the horizon and they
exactly. Exactly. But where they come out depends on what everything you throw in. Even in the distant future, you might be throwing in things. Well, what you throw in the distant future has a very little effect because those particles are very soft, as seen now.
Yeah.
But they will become hard later.
But let's just say they're coming out. And
yeah.
I mean, they're near the horizon.
Yes.
And I jump in.
Yes.
And maybe I carry a purification of one of these particles with me. I mean, are you claiming that I see the vacuum at the horizon?
Well, that's a very difficult question, and I'll have to postpone the answer to that, because it's not so simple. What I'm doing now is what I call the firewall transformation, which is I remove the firewall by transforming the hard particle into the soft out particle. So if time goes on, let's assume time goes forward, then the in particles become harder and harder and harder, because I'm going to later coordinate frames, where it seems as if they become harder. Hard meaning a high momentum beyond the Planck scale. And so I leave them away and replace them by these soft outgoing particles, which are a good way to characterize my Hilbert space. But now I've changed space-time because I've removed these incoming particles, so now I can go back and make the analytic continuation of that space-time. And that turns out to be very important, that originally, people would like to describe a black hole this way, saying I have only one quadrant of the Penrose diagram, I have out ingoing particles going in here. The outgoing particles, when you see particles coming out of the black hole, and I'm looking at the stationary case, where the black hole has a long past history, then I see outgoing particles coming out of the past event horizon. So the metric I'm using is I have a past event horizon, I have a future event horizon. Particles go in, and they cause particles to come out. So now you see the ingoing particles come out here, the outgoing particles come out here. What happened with that information? Did it go back to the past? No. And the point is that these outgoing particles come out much later in time. So actually, they don't come out here. They come out right here. And these ingoing particles don't really come in here, but they have to wait for some time. They actually come in here as well. So you can, better than saying that the information goes back to the past, you can say all the information is transmitted in this very corner. Of course, this is the active point of the black hole. This is the horizon, the in and outgoing event horizon cross each other at this point. This is where everything happens. Yes?
Well, let's say we blow up the vicinity of that point.
Yes.
Any point on the past horizon is in the past of any point on the future horizon.
Yes.
So if you have something going into the future horizon influencing something coming out of the past horizon, it already looks like you're sending something.
Okay, there's a reason to worry here. And that's absolutely correct. So, but I'm going to say that the ingoing particles will go in momentum space. The outgoing particle will go out in position space. So what you have to do before you want to have them in both in momentum or both in position space, one of the two has to be Fourier transformed. So the rule will be that the Fourier transform on this future event horizon is lying on the past event horizon. And it's always like that. If you look at the light cone description of a particle, you see that the wave function on the future event horizon is the Fourier transform of the wave function of the past horizon. And so what this point actually does, it turns a wave function into its Fourier transform. Yes?
I'm wondering whether, just for language, whether you mean something different by firewall than this idea.
Because well,
you said that you already transformed it away, but you also didn't answer my question about how come there's no firewall given that there's information in the outgoing radiation.
Originally, there is a firewall, but the rule of the Hilbert space is I only take the soft particles. They don't generate firewalls, not firewalls that I should be worried about. They go slower than the Planckian momentum. And so the firewall, by transforming from in to out, is saying the information carried by the in particle is now in the out particle. That's a transformation which at the same time removes the firewall caused by the in particle, because I take it into account in the out particle Hilbert space, not in the in particle Hilbert space. So that element is no longer there.
I'm going to make reference only to the outgoing particles.
Yes.
And so I don't really care how they got there and how they're related. I'm just if I assume, let's say there's an S wave going out through the new horizon zone.
Mm-hmm.
If that carries information and I fly in, I will not see the vacuum at the horizon. And I think we probably agree on that. And so long as these particles come from, the region between R and 3/2 R, when I fly through that region, I will see some kind of deviation from the vacuum. Which becomes
yes.
Large in the horizon.
Yes. I'll come to that because it's very important, but I have to define many of the rules. Yes? Can you shout?
How are you getting rid of the effect of the curvature?
The effect of the curvature due to these particles has disappeared because I've only concentrated on soft particles whose effect on the curvature is negligible. It's there, but I can take it into account by perturbative gravity. So there's some gravitons floating around, that's all. I think there's something. I'll come back to that. So, particular correlations and entanglement and so on.
Okay.
So, the rule will now be that because I've removed the ingoing particles from the picture, there's now no longer a very strong curvature on these lines. So now it's legitimate to make an analytic continuation. This analytic continuation, of course, is very strange because the original matter didn't have that, but now I can use it just for the purpose of defining my Hilbert space. And I have to define my Hilbert space here, but there is a problem, and that's a very deep and important problem, and that is that the outgoing particles are being shifted, but they're being shifted in terms of these coordinates here. These coordinates here are regular and smooth near the origin, and for the freely falling observer, this is the appropriate coordinate frame to use, but now I just said that the in particles cause the outgoing particles to shift. And their geodesics, the entire geodesics, are shifted with them. So if a particle came out here, then if it's shifted by a big distance, and I also explained to you the shift can become quite big, if it's shifted by a big distance, the ingoing particle, which or the argon particle which you thought came out here actually comes out here. Its entire geodesic comes out here. So now I have a problem to ask the question, what does this part of the whole diagram mean? And you've heard many times people say, this is something of the inside of the black hole. Well, I claim it can't be because it has these asymptotic domains. Any quantum system in a non-compact space-time will have a continuum of spectra. But we all know, we all love the idea of a black hole having a discrete spectrum. So there's something wrong there with saying that this is the inside of the black hole. It can't be. Well, Maldacena and Susskind have answered that. They say, well, this is another black hole. And then I ask, where is that other black hole? And somewhere in some universe there's this other black hole. But if you say that, you have a big problem. And the big problem is that due to the shift phenomenon, these two regions actually interact with each other. It's not an innocent interaction in words, like you're saying that these things are entangled. It's a real interaction. So think of the Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen experiment with two photons. But while two photons are far away, they still interact with each other. Well, that was not what Einstein, Rosen, and Podolsky assumed. They said they are entangled. They didn't say they are interacting. But these two regions do interact. So I'm not getting away with that. I think for two reasons. One is that I don't want to describe two black holes. I just want to describe a single black hole. And the other problem is that that not only there's entanglement, there's interaction. So I have to do something about this other region. But it comes about by this firewall transformation. I removed the firewall, but I got something in return that's very mysterious. I got something in return, which is this entire domain of Hilbert space, with Schwarzschild space, with its new asymptotic domains. And that's the difficulty that I have to face. Like everybody who works in black holes, sooner or later hits upon this problem. What does this corner mean? And I found that what I tried was something ridiculous, and in the beginning I did it completely wrong, but then I found that this somehow should explain, what we should do is divide the horizon of a black hole into two hemispheres. And one hemisphere is described by this corner, the other hemisphere is described by that corner. That, normally in physics, you can't get away with that, because that generates tremendous singularities at this point. In this case, it doesn't. And that's because I have the angular coordinates, theta and phi, have to be combined with the longitudinal coordinates, r and t. The r coordinate never becomes very small. The r coordinate is smallest here, it becomes bigger here, it becomes bigger there. It does become smaller in this domain, but I don't care much about that domain. I'll call it later 1, 2, 3, and 4. So I'm not so much interested what happens here. This, in a sense, is beyond the future, beyond the infinite future, because the infinite future is on this line. Time runs in this direction here, vertically. The infinite future sits here. This is somehow beyond the infinite future. Well, even if a particle would be entangled with a particle here, you'd say a particle in a time-like future of another particle, of course it will be entangled. It could be the same particle. So there's nothing to worry about with physics in this domain. But there's many, many reasons to worry about physics in this domain. But now I say that because the r coordinate is smallest here, but it becomes bigger here again in this direction, the r and t coordinates here are the same as the r and t coordinates here. So r becomes big again. And so there's a smaller spot where I can do that. But let me first, before continuing on that line, now do something that should answer some of the questions I already heard about particles being entangled and so on. This is now my Cauchy surface. And I can give it any shape I like. Of course, for all practical purposes, you can give it a very simple shape. But here, time runs to the future. Here also time runs to the future, but the future is in this direction. For the local observer, this is a very strange situation. The Cauchy surface goes to the future here, it goes to the past here. But that we knew. What is a time translation for a distant observer? It's a Lorentz transformation for the local observer. The Lorentz transformation, of course, also boosts time, but it boosts time in a way that depends on space. So it just gives a tilt on this line, but the line tilts smoothly. If I perform now a time translation for the distant observer, this Cauchy surface goes back to a straight horizontal line, more or less. And So that's what a time translation in a for a distant observer does. It makes, if this goes to the future, this also goes to the future, provided that it looks like going to the past for the local observer. So future and past are very peculiar notions if you compare a local observer with a global observer, with a distant observer. So you have to understand, if these were the Kruskal-Szekeres coordinates, then the ratio of the x-coordinate and y-coordinates, e to the power 2 times the scaled time parameter. This tau is time for the distant observer, but scaled by factor 2gm, so or 4gm, I even forgot. But anyway, it means that x will grow as e to the tau, y will shrink as e to the tau. And so that's, so if one coordinate expands, the other contracts, and that's of course what the Lorentz transformation always does in the light cone coordinates. So the future of this Schrödinger surface is here. So if I want to understand how Hilbert space goes, I just have to take these quantized fields and calculate them along this Schrödinger surface if I know them on the previous Schrödinger surface, and then I transform back, and I can transform back far away so that the Schrödinger surface is back to where it is here, and then continue. Everything is fine except at this point, because now particles get a big Lorentz boost for the local observer at this point, and some of the soft particles may become hard. Now I know what I have to do under such circumstances. I have to assume the information we transmitted from the past ingoing particle to the future outgoing particle. And that transmission is nothing else but a Fourier transformation. Well, I haven't said everything yet. Now I go back to this identification of region 2 with the other hemisphere of region 1. Normally speaking, this would be this space, the shape of space, space-like space-time. So at a fixed time, space looks like this. Of course, one dimension has been suppressed. This circle, smallest circle here, is actually a sphere. But the sphere has the smallest radius here. What I can do to this metric is I can identify points. So I can say that only half this metric is physical. The other half was already there, but at the antipolar points. On the other hemisphere, I have this line. So if I sit in the back of this metric, if I sit in the back of this metric and I'm getting out, then I hit this little pointed little circle on the horizon. This is the horizon. Then I flip over to this point. This point and this point is now identical. So these two points are identical, are declared to be identical. So if I try to get out, I hit this point, I go back in at the other side. So this is the entire space with its antipodes, and then this becomes redundant. I can also say I can take half of this space and half of that space and identify the antipode. Basically, I say these two sets of coordinates describe the same space-time point. I should count particles in this point and particles in that point, not twice, then I make a mistake. I should count them once. If you count them twice, you have a quantum cloning problem if you try to put a quantum field theory on that. If I do quantum field theory, I must put it on half the space only. Now I have gotten rid of the no cloning problem, because every point occurring once in this space-time also occurs once for the outside observer everywhere in the universe. It's very remarkable because it means that somehow the black hole has no inside. I'll explain a little bit here. This is a space, you could say, and the inside of the black hole is a vacuole, I call it, some empty spot inside. This is why it's just empty spot inside space-time. But there is no space-time inside. If I come from outside, I hit this cross, I flip over to the antipode of this cross. So imagine this to be a sphere, and these crosses being at the antipodes on the sphere. This horizon is not an ordinary S2 sphere. It's a projective S2 sphere, meaning that it's actually a space of lines. That means that this point describes the same line as that point. So this point is identified at that point. And it holds all the way. So if you enter, for some reason, you enter here in space-like directions, you really, really emerge there immediately. However, time stands still on the horizon. At least time for the distant observer stands still on the horizon. So when you cross from here to here, actually you invert time. As you saw, time runs backward on the other half of this space. So when you continuously connect this point to that point, you can't actually travel this way because there are no geodesics which do that. Because you have to go faster than the local speed of light. So it means something about the topology of space-time, but not about actually being able to travel to the other side of the black hole. If you could travel faster than light, than the local speed of light, you'd be able to go from region 1 to region 2. I call this thing a vacuole, but actually it's a vacuole in four-dimensional space-time, 3 plus 1. So because time inverts, actually, you have also the antipodes in the time direction. So you have to imagine this to be a S3 sphere, S3 projective sphere, rather than an S2 projective sphere. So this is basically an instanton. It's a very nice instanton because it just says there is no inside in the black hole. This point is connected to that point. And, okay, you have to make some, you get some curvature in your space-time when you do that. In a conformal theory, you can do this without much punishment. But if the theory is not conformal, then you have to do some work to make this work. And you'll get a physically interesting-looking topological instanton. And it has been worked on by these people in Utrecht. But they thought they found an instanton, but I think there's some difficulties with it. It's not really as regular as it should be. So, but they started to use that instanton as an exercise for doing calculations on that kind of instanton. Yes?
I have some, I guess, firewall unrelated questions.
Yes.
One is, what is the formula for the area of the horizon in terms of the radius? Is it half or?
No, that's just the conventional. I'm not changing the metric. I'm only changing the boundary conditions.
Well, I thought you were identifying the pivotal points on the horizon.
Yes.
So doesn't that...
Okay, the total surface area looks like being half of the original surface area. I see. And... well, the whole thing is, it's not a thermal theory anymore. So you can't define entropy the way you would like to define it. So whether the entropy is the entire surface or half the surface depends on what you want to call entropy. The thing is, if I have states defined on one hemisphere, then I know the states on the other hemisphere.
Can we say the entropy is the thing that's defined by the usual laws of thermodynamics? So let's say
yes.
Variation of
Well, the temperature remains the same, just what Hawking calculated. And that's because if you look at the... Sorry?
But then the first law will be violated if your entropy is only half of what it used to be.
I don't think the entropy is half, but it depends a little bit how you collect your information. You see, in principle, if even in a light bulb and it emits light, it is only one quantum state. But that's not the way we like to talk about light bulbs. We like to define the entropy of a light bulb, saying how many states it can be in. Now, the big problem is, at the other hemisphere of the black hole, can it be in different states? The answer is yes. Only on the horizon, the states are identified. But as soon as you go away from the horizon, they're no longer identified.
My other question is just purely geometric. So, for example, let's consider a black hole that's formed by the collapse of a null shell. So it's this very simple situation where the event horizon is, you've got a Minkowski space below the null shell, and then the event horizon is basically a continuation of a future light cone that comes out of r equals 0.
There's a problem with the dust shell.
So this is just null dust. But I mean, we could choose any other simple collapse situation. I'm just doing this so we have a specific geometry in mind where I can think of continuing the event horizon down to r equals 0 below whatever made the black hole form. And I'm just asking, these could be physical objects like light rays, I mean, actual photons traveling up. What happens to them? They're initially in S2, and then they become this projective sphere. How does that happen dynamically?
That's a very important question, and I don't have the complete answers here. The answers I have, what I can handle very well doing this method is stationary or nearly stationary black holes. The formation of a black hole is quite another story. And what you can say, well, a black hole might start out very small. That's not quite right, as you might point out, that a black hole can be made out of a dust shell, and it starts out being very large from the beginning. But the horizon opens up at a certain spot. At that spot, You could say that if you take the cross-sectional horizon with a Cauchy surface, the black hole size is very small. But you're only describing vacuum space. So there must be ways of describing the vacuum as if it was actually a growing black hole, because you see the horizons opening up. But this
region is, I mean, the knowledge that this is an event horizon is, as you know very well, it's acausal, right? To have any information that this is going to be an event horizon would violate causality.
True. So you have to make a transformation that assumes that you know something about the future, but that's just a transformation of coordinates. So physically, of course, nothing happens in a point where the black hole where the horizon just opens up. It's just vacuum or nearly vacuum. So those are very important questions. I don't have all the answers there, but I can only say that once you know, once you've described the black hole in terms of all the ingoing particles that made them, at that point I can decide to erase the ingoing particles, and then I get this picture. But erasing the ingoing particles is not such an innocent action as you might think from what I said so far. If you had that impression it's simple, then I have to make some sobering remarks. It's not so simple. So also the black hole formation process is hard. The same thing that's hard is the final evaporation of the black hole. So those are the difficult spots in the theory. And one reason why they are difficult is now you really need Planckian physics. And I don't understand all the Planckian physics, as you can imagine. That's something like string theory or something beyond string theory, I don't know. I hope, in the converse, that this will give you indications as to how to proceed from here. And one of the big questions is indeed black hole formation. And some of the answers I cannot give there. But I can give the answer to how a stationary black hole behaves, and that is completely determined by ordinary laws of physics. That's my main theme, the stationary black hole. How it got formed is quite a more difficult question.
There's another question. We did build in some time for discussion, but I'm wondering how much longer you need to finish the presentation so we can have discussion now.
What about Sky Infinity?
What's that?
Sky Infinity. I can go on forever.
Okay, well, what do you really need to
do? Okay. Well, at least say 10 minutes or so.
Okay, so that would get us a little past. So is it a quick question?
It's a quick question. I just missed the argument because the justification that you give for changing the topology, for having this antipodal matching, comes from a boundary condition that you require at the bifurcation surface of the joining the two sides of the black hole.
Yes.
But it looks to me that you only need that all the particles and all the matter fields have to obey that boundary condition. And you could get along with imposing the boundary condition just on the matter fields, not on changing the topology of the space-time.
For a local observer, it wouldn't be needed, what I said. But for a global observer, I think it is. Because I really need a single asymptotic domain. I need to define the instates of scattering matrix and the outstates in the ordinary universe. Right. I don't want to have to invoke another universe. And it really means if you go to the other side of the black hole, you're making a big journey, say. And now you say, now in order to make the ends come together in this theory, I must do something about this other, this region 2 of the black hole. I can't leave it the way it is. So the obvious answer is antipolar identification. It's really antipodes, not some other more complicated transformation, because that doesn't work.
Identification you're making is the identification on the screen there, and so it's only the bifurcation surface where you kind of lose half the sphere, right?
Yes.
If I'm way up on the future horizon, I've got a full sphere's worth of horizon there.
Yes.
So I think that's answering.
So the outside world looks the same as it always did.
Yeah.
But on the horizon, I have the identification. So it means that basically, I've cut out the interior of the black hole.
No, I understand. It's just, I think, the idea that there's only half an area on the horizon isn't really the problem, or there's no problem.
So that's the question. I mean, if Gerard had answered what you just said, I would have been happier. I agree with that. But that doesn't. He seems to be contradicting. So the question is the sphere only half the sphere?
Don't listen to his words.
Only the horizon the horizon has these two points identified. As soon as you go away,
which
you,
part of the horizon, just the bifurcation surface or all of the horizon?
The bifurcation surface, because x and y are light cone coordinates. If any of the x and y or y are unequal to zero, then this is a different. So then this point is different from that point. There are only the other, so I'm just saying that I'm reaching the negative values for x and y by just going from theta to pi minus theta, and this is the antipodal formula. So these two points are identified, but if the x and y are not both zero, that doesn't mean much physically. It just means that, okay, I'm not saying it right. It does mean something physically, of course, because I've reduced the total number of the points in space-time by a factor 2. So I reduced my universe by half.
So in that case, I would have to ask my question differently. There is no bifurcation surface in the original collapsed space-time.
Where
did it come from?
So I think this comes about by redefining the origin of x and y being zero. Because I had to redefine that because this shift became an infinite shift. And I can't handle that kind of infinity, so I have to redefine the origin. So actually, the origin being x equals 0 and y equals 0 has been redefined. And this redefinition apparently comes with a price. This seems to be coming out of thin air, but there really is no other solution to my problem. So it's the only solution that works, and I say, let's embrace it, and now indeed everything falls into place. That's the main message. You might not like it, and I didn't like it in the beginning, there's something crazy about it. But then I realized that by doing this, everything falls in its place. That's the most important message. So this is the famous Hart-to-Hawking state. Now, the conventional interpretation, and the one which also Hawking gave, is that these points in region 2 are never seen, so you have to average over them, and then you get a thermal state. Now, if I say that these particles, there are lots of particles there, they're on the other hemisphere, not only the black hole, but also the entire universe. You average over them, and if you're looking with a telescope at the black hole, you happen to see only one hemisphere, not the other one. So, at that hemisphere, you then say, okay, the other hemisphere I can't see, I average over them. As soon as you do that, you get the conventional Hawking temperature back. So in a telescope, the black hole will look just like what Hawking predicted. So Hawking would shout and jump that he made a marvelous discovery, and he did, of course. So that's fine. But now I'm saying E, the particles with energy E and quantum numbers N in region 2 are there for everybody to see. You just have to go around the black hole and watch the other hemisphere. And that means that this is now a pure state. It's not a mixed state anymore. And that's the biggest departure. And then now describing entire black holes in terms of pure states only. And as you don't look at the states too, then you still see the same thermal mixture that Hawking derived. Because of this, now I reduce entire universe by a factor 2, so I don't have a doubling of the asymptotic regions anymore. And that I really need if I want to compute a scattering matrix or evolution operator. And what I'll do now is I'll go to the eternal black hole. And that's now the rule of the game. I haven't understood very well the formation of black hole. I haven't understood quite completely the final evaporation of black hole. Those are things still are under investigation. But what I do understand this way is how the black hole behaves in between. From the moment it was formed, you still have lots of ingoing particles around. Then you say, okay, I'm transforming these away by the procedure I just explained. Same thing with the final evaporation. The out particles are being transformed away. It's just a time reversal. The whole picture is completely invariant on a time reversal. And also other time translations. Now, I'll skip these particles, these things. I can come back to them later. What I want to show is the actual calculation. And this is where the whole thing becomes interesting, because I can say anything to you, but if I don't calculate something, I might make all sorts of mistakes. But that can be avoided by this fundamental trick, which of course is very well known in physics. I expand the spherical harmonics. Now I take the momentum distribution of the incoming particle, expand them in spherical harmonics, and do the same thing with the position operator of the particles. I can go into position space, I can go to momentum space. And now the wave function in momentum space is the wave function I'm going to look at. And the wave function in position space is very easy to get out of that by just Fourier transforming with respect to momentum. And now this shift here was a logarithm, remember. And that logarithm is a nasty function of the transverse separation. But in angular coordinates, that logarithm happens to be the solution of a Laplace equation. Also in flat space, it's a solution of Laplace equation in two dimensions. So the horizon was two-dimensional when I started, the way I started. And this logarithm I talked about actually was is going to be replaced by a Green's function. But if you go from flat space to a spherical topology, the Green's function is a bit more complicated. But in terms of the spherical harmonics, it becomes very easy. The Green's function is the inverse of L square plus L plus 1 on acting on the states being the right-hand side of the equation. That's just a Laplace equation in flat space or in curved space. But the Laplace equation is trivial to solve once you go to spherical harmonics, because it just means you have to divide by L square plus L plus 1. This plus 1 is not trivial. Yeah, it's a hard calculation, actually. But it turns out to be like this, L square plus L plus 1. So that's the thing you can invert. And you can get the solution of the positions if you know the momentum distribution. So this is the actual shift formula. And once you say this, and once you say that the relation between U and P are just the quantum commutators, then in L and M space, just at every L and M, there's a U plus and a U minus, and there's a P plus and a P minus. They obey this commutation rule. But the relation between the U's and the P's are just given by the shift equation. Now, if you write this shift equation in for the ingoing particles, P minus goes to U minus out, then if from this commutation rule alone, you can already derive this. So this is why I said that the shift of the out of the in particles caused by the out ones and the shift of the out particles caused by the in ones, it's the same physics. That's because you just use this commutation rule to find if this holds, then this holds. There's a minus sign, just a notation question. But if you interchange the commutator, then you get the minus sign. But otherwise, it's the same shift expression. And now, the remarkable thing here is that every L and M completely decouples from every other L and M. So the calculation becomes very simple. At every given L and M, I only have to solve these equations in L and M. And what you find is there's only one coordinate U plus and one coordinate P minus at the given L and M. The others, P minus and P plus, are then related by this equation, so it's all fixed. So it's basically only one parameter. It's one plus one dimensional field theory, quantum theory with first quantization only. Every undergraduate student can solve these equations. They're even simpler than a hydrogen atom. So these equations can easily be solved. And what you then get is the scattering matrix. And I have to add one more thing. Not only can I use these spherical harmonics, I can do something similar in the time direction. Time for the distant observer is a complete symmetry now of the system. The way I describe this this Penrose diagram and the states on their Cauchy surface is invariant under time translations. So my black hole equations are all time translation invariant. Also, if I go from time to minus time, I have a complete symmetry. So I can do the same things as we do everywhere else in quantum theory. I can go to the energy eigenstates. So look at the energy eigenstates of an ingoing particle in momentum space, so at a given L. Then you can calculate, you can just do this Fourier transformation for this one variable, which is a very trivial calculation, but it gives a 2x2 matrix. Why? Well, I have the region 1 and the region 2. And I have particles with energy can be defined in region 1, particles with energy can be defined in region 2, but now they are related. Region 1 and region 2 are related by the shift operation, by saying that the outgoing particles are the Fourier transforms of the ingoing particles. That gives you this outcome. I skipped the calculation. It's only about 5 to 10 minutes, but I don't have those. So I just skipped the transformation, but it's a 2x2 matrix. And these Fs are just straightforward calculations that anybody can do. They just give the Euler functions, it so happens to be. And the Euler function has some nice properties, that the gamma of x and times the gamma of 1 minus x is 1 over a sine or a cosine in this case. And so you can use those equations to prove this is a unitary matrix. This is just a scaled, a phase transformation, so this doesn't, this by itself is unitary. And this matrix is unitary because this is exactly the condition you need for this matrix to be a unitary matrix. And this is obeyed by the gamma functions. So everything is fine. This is a unitary matrix that relates in to out. Exactly what I wanted to achieve. And so you see, I've applied mostly standard physics. I've done some crazy things, perhaps, but it all comes out correct. It all works precisely this way. If I had done anything else, it wouldn't have worked. So the important message is, okay, you're welcome to challenge everything I did. Please replace it by your own favorite theory and try to do the same calculation. And I claim you can only get a unitary S matrix if you did it the way which I found by trial and error, making lots of errors, by the way, but then finally you find out this is the only way to do it correctly. And this procedure works. So now there's a remarkable thing. Only the odd values of L. Wait a minute, what's happening here? I can't use even L. And the reason is extremely simple. If I go to the antipodes, my x and y coordinates switch sign. So if the x and y coordinates I use as coordinates for the in and out particles, then going to the other hemisphere changes the sign of the x and y. So I can only use spherical harmonics which change sign when I go to the other hemisphere. And those are the odd L spherical harmonics. They change sign, the even L's don't. So I cannot use even L, and there goes my dust shell. So you asked about dust shell. I can say, okay, I can handle everything, but not the dust shell, because that would be an S wave, and that is even L, which is L equals zero. I can't do L equals zero. And that means that the dust shell must be taken for what it is. It's dust. There are billions of particles, which are all in a very high L mode. And those L's you have to take into account. So the story becomes quite complex. And you have to really understand how this Hilbert space is being formed. And you discover that only odd L values of L participate in the game. The even L's just don't exist. They are zero. And that's something, as I said, needs to be studied a bit further, what the implications of this is. Actually, it also means that if you throw in a dust shell with even L, you have to do quite some work to say, no, this is actually not even L at all. It's even L for the local observer, the freely falling observer. It's not even L for the distant observer. The distant observer can have energies which are invariant under rotations. So the energy distribution for the distant observer can be a spherical wave, but not just one single particle. It consists of very, very many particles, each of which having a large L value. So there is and you have to think about it. I don't have the time to get the entire story there. But so the dust shell is not a legal state. That's a very important thing, and I'm sure you can ask questions. Total energy is conserved. What's nice about this is that the ingoing particle is immediately transformed to an outgoing particle, but the energy remains the same. The energy of in the L variables at fixed L and M, the energy of the ingoing wave equals the energy of the outgoing wave because it all diagonalizes. And energy is, and time translation is in symmetry, so you can't go from one energy state to a different energy state. So so you have to look at fixed energy states, and that means now you can ask, how can a black hole mass change with time? Well, that's easy. I also have the states in the asymptotic domain. The outgoing particles go out all the way. The ingoing particles come from infinity. As long as they're far away from the black hole, they carry their own energy, but that energy doesn't add to the energy of the black hole, so the black hole mass is lighter. But when the particle comes very close to the black hole, and as long as the particle is very close, and also the outgoing particle is still very close, at that moment the energy of the black hole is a bit higher. Now, an ordinary particle is not in a pure single LM state, but is a mixture of many different L and M. So the real wave functions are always much more complicated than this. So it could be that for a long time there are many particles inside, residing inside the black hole. Then they add to the mass of the black hole, but when they're outside, you say you have to count them separately, and the mass of the remaining black hole is then lighter than it was before. So the black hole mass can change with time. And that's just a desirable, physically necessary feature anyway. So the procedure is internally consistent. So there is a problem. There's a problem which has been asked me several times also. And how long does a particle reside in a black hole? The answer is the particle itself stays there only a very short time, as seen by the local observer. But the global observer doesn't see a single particle there. He sees a Hart-Hawking state. He always has this infinite stream of ingoing particles and infinite stream of outgoing particles. That's the Hart-Hawking state. If you remove any of the incoming particles, you go from one state to a different state. If you have different ingoing particles, you'll have different outgoing particles. That's the unitarity demand. The unitarity demand is obeyed, but in my LM basis, which is not the basis of single particles. So this Hilbert space, yes, it looks like a single, simple Hilbert space. Actually, it's quite complicated in terms of the original particles. So, but you see there's a mixture of Hart-Hawking particles, which are everywhere all the time. They stay inside the black hole for eternity, in a sense. It's not the same particles going in and what are going out. But all the modifications are given by the LM mode. So the LM modes are not the entire story of the ingoing and outgoing particles. No, they are the extent to which the in and outgoing particles deviate from the Hart-Hawking state. The Hart-Hawking state is a single state, both of in and outgoing particles. And if the all ingoing particles forever are in a Hart-Hawking state, then the outgoing particles will automatically also be in a Hart-Hawking state. So that is an important thing to remember. Or here is, and then I should really stop. Here is, what's this? A remarkable thing. The Fourier transform in the exponentiated variables, so in exponentiated variables, you look at, this is the Fourier transform. It can't be easier than that. We're all familiar with it. And but now I'm going to exponentiate. I'm going to say x is a sine, sigma x is just plus or minus, times an exponent. And the momentum is also a sine times an exponent. Now, what is this if I replace the x and the p by exponents? Well, it becomes this horrible-looking function. Well, it looks horrible. It's not that horrible. But it's something which has a canonical factor of an exponential in front. You get an exponentially decreasing thing here. This kernel becomes a very rapidly oscillating kernel, and it oscillates forever with even an exponentially increasing amplitude. But the frequency goes very fast. Now, you might think that doesn't converge to anything, but when you multiply that with the energy state of the energy operator, is just an ordinary wave with respect to time. This is the time coordinate. So the constant energy is just a wave. If I convolute this oscillating thing with this wave function, I only get the contribution from somewhere here. I don't get any contribution from these rapidly oscillating modes. And here also the contribution is damped exponentially quite quickly. So I don't get much here, I don't get much here. All the contributions come from here. As if this were a kernel with a compact support. The support is not compact because it goes on forever, but the oscillation goes so fast you can ignore that. You know that very well if you go back to Fourier space, that yes, if x or p become very large, this thing starts to oscillate so strongly that under all circumstances this is a unitary operation. It's not that innocent, however, and there's a danger if you can't rid yourself of these very fast oscillations. But for all energy eigenstates, that disappears. And that guarantees unitarity. So that guarantees why the whole scheme works, that I can throw away the contributions from very long time differences. These are very short time differences. They all go away exponentially. So this converges. This is the reason why it converges. But if you're asking certain questions of the kind that Rafael has been bombarding me with yesterday, and he's right to do that, but I think it's one of the difficulty is lying right here, that you can't see how these very high oscillations somehow give a negligible vanishing contribution. But this is how unitarity is restored in the whole frame. And I should really end here, so I did manage to go through my slides. Thank you for giving me the time.
Questions, but we should go have our coffee break so we can get back to the next discussion. Jonathan, we haven't heard from you.
If you had instead found that things were non-unitary, you would have found you could have interpreted it as an extra Hilbert space, which you no longer had access to.
Mm-hmm.
And then here you get something maybe related where you have this extended black hole Hilbert space that you're interpreting as still, well, you're interpreting this extra Hilbert space as being the extended part of the black hole.
The other side of the
other
black
side.
Hole.
And I'm wondering what's the difference between the two calculations which tell you that?
Well, the calculation remains the same. So the calculation is, are you talking about two black holes? Are you talking about what? Is region one and region two, are there two different black holes? Well, you'll get the same answer. So that estimate that you wrote down is the same estimate if you had two black holes. But then I say, wait a minute, that means the two black holes are talking to each other. Now I say the two hemispheres of the black hole are talking to each other. Who cares? That's just interesting physics. Nothing wrong with it. But if it is with two separate black holes that are arbitrarily far separated from each other, but they're talking to each other all the time, they're sending messages, that can't be right. So physically, I think you can't accept that. Mathematically, it doesn't matter. Mathematicians will solve any equation you give to them. So they solve this one as well, they get the same answer.
So, and why is that different from an interpretation where you say this is just non-unitary?
Or if you want to drop unitarity, that's fine, but I haven't seen any other physical system where you could drop unitarity that easily. Because I want to have conservation of probabilities. How can I drop unitarity?
Unless I drop quantum mechanics altogether.
I mean
information loss, so remaining probabilities, but where you get a mixed state. I don't mean, so when I say non-unitary...
Of course, you can mix these quantum states as much
yes.
as you want.
I just mean, what in the calculation is different from saying that I have this region of the Hilbert space where I can no longer see the information there versus interpreting it as part of the other hemisphere of the black hole?
Well, my priority was find the theory. I don't know whether I will succeed from in advance. Maybe I would not have succeeded. But now... I consider my assignment, find a quantum theory that's unitary, that handles probabilities the way we always handle probabilities, and that takes into account physics, which I believe in, near a black hole. And this is the answer that works. I think this is the only answer to the question that works. I don't think there's another way. So we have to be bothered about this non-uniqueness problem, which I said in all the quantum field theories, I have many more states that I can't handle this way. So there's going to be work to be done. And I think this theory might, in the very end, give us information about that quantum field theory. Not all quantum field theories will work. So I say this is the beginning of a big program that will go on forever and probably to see how close can we get into guessing the right quantum field theory. That's why we're having this meeting here at CERN. And CERN, they're measuring things about this quantum field theory. And we don't know where all these crazy top quarks and so on come from. But we want to find out. And maybe gravity is the answer. Maybe black holes is the beginning of an answer.
Okay. That's a good discussion to continue over the coffee break, I think. And so let's come back at 10:40, 20 minutes. And there will be time for more discussion more broadly of black holes this afternoon as well. So I'm sure some of these things will come up again. So let's thank
you.